Major support for Louisiana Eats on WWNO provided by Zatarain's, proud producers of authentic New Orleans-style cuisine. Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889.
From WWNO New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. The healing power of food comes in many forms. At Triumph Kitchen in Baton Rouge and at Liberty's Kitchen in New Orleans, healing comes through hands-on culinary programs that impart invaluable life skills to at-risk youth. After founders Chris and Sommer Wadsworth share Triumph Kitchen's story, we'll have a taste of the Healthy School Lunch Program initiated by Liberty's Kitchen. Then, we'll hear from Chef Ryan Hughes, who's about to depart for Russia, armed with filet powder and crab boil. Can he heal diplomatic relations with delicious Louisiana food? Food healing the world, both at home and abroad, on this week's Louisiana Eats. Chef Chris Wadsworth began his life in food with a dishwashing job at the Catfish Shack in Lafayette. Much to his parents' dismay, Chris dropped out of school at the age of 15 to pursue his dream of becoming a chef. In June of 2012, Chris made an indelible mark on the Baton Rouge food scene as opening chef at restaurant IPO. Recognizing how food turned his life around, the young rising star decided to take a different path. He and his wife, Summer, founded Triumph Kitchen, a 14-week program for at-risk youth with hands-on training in every aspect of the restaurant business. We joined them on location in Baton Rouge.
So, like you did say, it is 12 weeks in-house with a 2-week job placement. So, total were 14 weeks. Our students start with an application process online at triumphkitchen.org. And from there, we go through multiple interviews just to kind of screening who we think can really benefit the best from the program, who's doing it just because mom and dad say they have to, or maybe it's a probation officer says, hey, you need to get a job. So we truly do filter through the ones that we think that we can absolutely help the most. There's got to be some drive in the beginning. Our students have got to want it for themselves. We can help push that a little bit, but there's got to be something deep down inside them that says, you know what, I want to do something with my life and I need some job skills for sure. So they start with us after this process is complete, and they go through the 12 weeks in-house. It's everything from back of the house, front of the house, barista, hostess, cash handling, guest service skills, phone skills, even the janitorial side of it. I mean, they learn every avenue of this business. And the thing that I tell people every day is, at the end of the 12 weeks, if they say, okay, chef, I don't want to be in this industry anymore, well, that's okay too, because you just picked up customer service skills, which you can use in anything. Now you know how to work for a boss. You know how to work with coworkers. You know how to handle cash. Ms. Summers taught you how to do your resume, how to apply for jobs, how to interview correctly. You know, these are the type of things that can be used in any industry. So it's certainly not our goal to create 15 to 20 chefs every semester. I would love it, you know, but it's not for everybody.
Give me a thumbnail sketch of who these kids are.
They come from all walks of life. You know, skin color, eye color, they look just like you and I, but just need that one person to just say, you know what, I'm going to care about you, and we're going to make it happen. Come to me with your dreams, and that's what we're going to shoot for. Physically looking at them, no, you can't tell that they come from a rough background, but during our life skill class, we really get into, you know, I share personal stories about my own life, Chef shares his personal stories, and you really, they open up and start sharing without realizing that they're even sharing.
I dropped out of school when I was 15. I have no culinary degree. I have no college degree. I fought my way to the top. And yes, I was, you know, I've had my really big accomplishments, and that's something we can share with them. For me to be able to say, hey, look, guys, I've been there, but this is where we need to be, and this is how you accomplish it, you know, it makes it more of a kind of a dog the bounty hunter style.
What were some of the obstacles in this very first go-round that really surprised you?
There's several obstacles. Obviously, being a nonprofit, the financial side of it is a constant obstacle. We've been blessed in many ways the way that this place has been funded. You know, I can tell you that personally, we have everything we own in this business, and it's because we believe in it, and it's all we want to do right now. But, you know, just little obstacles of, I guess even the downtown businesses are kind of like, okay, well, we're bringing in all these bad kids, and we're going to bring them all into downtown, and we're trying to clean up downtown. And I'm trying to explain to them that, you know, if you go into the kitchen of any restaurant in any major city and start pulling background checks, you're going to be in a world of trouble. You know what I mean?
Just about every great chef either still is or has been a bad kid, wouldn't
That's
you
right.
say?
Absolutely. They say every good chef has had one of three problems. He's either been a gambler, a drug addict, or an alcoholic. So, you know, at one given time, all of us have done one of those three and had an issue with it. Most of the time, everybody goes through a run of bad luck. And some of it is predetermined, some of it's self-determined, some of it's, you know, uncontrollable. But with any of our kids, we do find them, let's say they are homeless, but they are definitely found homes, they are found places to live. That's number one step in being successful, is having a safe home and bed to go home to at night, and being able to regroup and get your thoughts together. So that's something we're very passionate about, but we do work with several organizations around town that find housing for them. So, you know, that was certainly an obstacle, was people saying, oh, look, you know, I don't know if we want these kids down here, you know. But when I start putting my own name on them and showing my own passion, you know, it's a different ball game now. You know, the mayor's involved here, the DA's involved, lieutenant governor. I mean, they're all supporters of ours. So it just took a little while.
So what are your dreams and goals for the future?
You know, dreams and goals would be, I mean, obviously Triumph to be talked about and have a wait list, which we're accomplishing that because our next semester is already full. Continuing just reaching out to these kids who feel like they don't have someone who cares for them. That's really the best feeling, is knowing that they're coming here and they're going to be part of our family.
As far as my own personal goals and as a chef, I think I've accomplished a lot of what I wanted to already, which is kind of what we do now. You know, my chef coat doesn't even say chef on it anymore because it's not about me. So I've kind of gotten away from that whole executive chef mentality. But, you know, as far as goals for Triumph, you know, we look to continue growing. Obviously, our 2,700 square foot kitchen is in its final stages right now. And, you know, I'd love to put it in other cities. I'd love to get it elsewhere. I'd like to build a coalition between the ones in New Orleans and Baton Rouge. I'd love for Baton Rouge culinary scene to finally be recognized as a force to be reckoned with. You know, we've celebrated long-term restaurants here for years, but have never celebrated the chefs that were behind it, which is different than New Orleans and Lafayette. They truly get behind the chefs, and Baton Rouge has struggled in that area. So I think with our school and focusing on who's in the kitchen, Louisiana Culinary Institute is a good partner of ours as well, building the chefs for tomorrow. You know, all those make a big difference for Baton Rouge.
I got one last question that I'm just really compelled to ask the two of you, because the two of you, so you've got six kids of your own, and you strike me as being inordinately warm and loving people. And yet I know there is no way that you can be running this place without a lot of tough love going on. So where does the tough love come in?
The tough love comes in every day, whether it's during life skills, kitchen skills. Yes, we're look and operate just like a restaurant, but we can lock the front doors if we need to discuss whatever's going on with our students. I tend to be a little more aggressive in the tough love just because the mama in me comes out and the teacher, so they kind of get to see both sides of that with me. I'm not saying that Chef doesn't do the tough love. He's just a little, he does it differently than I do. You know, I do the whole mama thing. I don't scream, but I get that mama tone in my voice, and the kids just kind of look at me like, deers in the headlights, like, okay, yeah, she's mad. Yeah. And it's not that I'm mad. They haven't done anything to make us mad. It's just, you're not thinking this through. Let's refocus, and it needs to get done. You know, because I want better for them, and I know that they want better for themselves as well.
One of the things that I carry with me, and this is very similar to my parenting style, is that disappointment's going to weigh a lot heavier on you than if I jump in your face like Gordon Ramsay. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't have to be doing this. They've all seen my resume. They've Googled me. They know what I've done. You know, I don't have to be here. I could be anywhere else that I wanted to right now, but I choose to give my life to them. So the disappointment and failure from them is truly heavy on them, for sure.
Chris and Sommer, I just want to congratulate you all on this amazing visionary work that you are just getting rolling here in Baton Rouge. And thank you so much for sharing your story. please keep us posted as to what comes next with Triumph Kitchen, because this is a story we definitely would like to follow. Thank you.
Thank you. We enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Summer and Chris Wadsworth of Triumph Kitchen in Baton Rouge. Founded in April of 2009, Liberty's Kitchen was conceived as a cafe where at-risk teens and young adults could acquire marketable life skills, learning the insides and outs of the culinary world. A little more than a year later, Liberty's Kitchen initiated the Healthy School Lunch Program, which provides daily nutritious breakfast, lunch, and snacks for over 600 students at New Orleans College Prep Charter School.
We run a 12-week program for young people between 16 and 22, and we don't call ourselves a culinary program. We feel like we're more of a job training program. We believe that a lot of skills that our young people gain while they spend the time with us are transferable to whatever it is that they want to do. However, we're in New Orleans, and it just makes sense for us to do it in a restaurant. So we do a small cafe on Broad Street. We do catering outlet site as well. And this morning we're at New Orleans College Prep where we do the food services. That's breakfast and lunch for 900 students. And this actually is an ideal training ground for young people just to work. They have to be here for 7.5 hours a day, all day, nonstop. They're on their feet. They're working. So they really have a full and it's a long day. And I tell them all the time, they can get through the first 6 weeks, I'm convinced they're ready to work. At that point, what we do is we bring them over to the cafe where we really focus on their fine skills. We have a limited menu, covers all the cooking methods that they'll need to know if they're interested in working in this industry. And it also covers customer service, they interact with our public, as well as work the cash register. We combine that with employability. We don't guarantee them any jobs. We guarantee them that they know how to do a resume. They can always come back and update. We guarantee that they're prepared for an interview. We guarantee that they know how to complete an application. We guarantee that they get references from us. We will bring them to interview. We will bring them to drop off applications. We just don't guarantee a job. However, we believe in our program. We believe that if they do what we ask them to do, they'll be working by the end of the 12 weeks. We've had 29 graduates, and I believe 25 of them walked out of our program into a job. And all of them actually were working within 2-3 weeks after the program ended.
What do you find the greatest challenge with these kids is?
A major barrier that we run into is housing for our young people. If all intents and purposes, our students are generally homeless. And that's not 100% of them, but a large percent of our students really don't know where they're going to sleep next week. They may have a place secure for tonight or for the next 2 days, but for the most part, they're living out of a bag. And my guess is that a lot of that has to do with the fact that families were displaced after the storm. They still haven't come home, and they definitely haven't come home to the place that they call home. And so there's still some settling that hasn't been done yet. And we see it every day. You know, it's not uncommon at all for me to get a call at 3 o'clock in the morning. Somebody needs a place to live. They've just been kicked out of where they're staying, and they just got to go. Or for me to come to work 7 o'clock in the morning and find one of our young people who's already there, who's, you know, obviously has been there for a while.
Well, I want to thank you so much for taking time out of such a busy day to spend a little time with us on Louisiana Eats.
It is always a treat to spend time with you, Poppy. Thank you.
Kristen Lozada is the Chief Operating Officer at the New Orleans College Prep Charter School. And in her role, she's largely responsible for what goes on around here, even down to lunch. So tell me, Kristen, how'd you make this happen?
Well, ultimately, it was really our desire to provide the best possible services to our students. We believe that they deserve all possible opportunities that match, you know, other college prep charter schools or other college prep private schools across the country. And from my experience, we weren't offering them school food that matched, you know, the Newmans, the Ben Franklins of the world, let alone the Metairie Country Days or the Exeters up in the Northeast. So it really became a priority for me to make sure that we were offering them the freshest, most healthy options that we could to expose them to new foods and to show them that they deserve the best services that they possibly can, regardless of their background or where they've grown up.
Describe for me your student body. Who are these kids?
Well, our student body is 99% African American and 96.5% low income. So most of these kids come to us while not really having the opportunities in the previous schools. And a lot of them, you know, we have about 25% homeless at this point. So some of them come to us without having had a meal. And so they really rely on us to be able to provide them with the best possible food that we can to help them get through the day. It was a very difficult process to be able to get Liberty's Kitchen here at New Orleans College Prep. Lots of bureaucratic paperwork, a lot of different evaluations that we needed to go through to get SFA status, which is the School Food Authority status. But ultimately, you know, all of our recipes ended up being approved. It just took many months and many processes and different revisions to be able to be in compliance with USDA at all times while still providing the quality of food that we wanted to provide to our kids.
Thank you so much for talking with us.
Oh, anytime. Thank you.
Chef Kevin Hackett is in charge of the kitchen here at New Orleans College Prep Charter School. He's having a big influence on menus and on all the people touching the food. Welcome to Louisiana Eats.
Thank you, Poppy. It's great to be here.
Tell me about the kids who are here in the kitchen working for you.
Well, our kids are great. I might be a little prejudiced, but I think our kids are great. Most of them have very little or no kitchen experience whatsoever. They come to us referred through various organizations from the justice system, the schools, everywhere. When they're part of the program, they're required to get their GED if they don't have it already. We pay them a small stipend, but in order to get that stipend, they have to set up their own bank accounts and do direct deposit. So we're teaching them a lot of life skills on top of that. The kids are varied, you know. Some of them are a lot rougher than others. Some of them come from some really hard situations, and some of them have had it a little better. Almost across the board, like I said, they have almost no work experience. And we are a job training organization. We are not specifically a culinary training organization. I'm not trying to turn out chefs here, though we have had a few chefs come out of the program. But mostly we're just trying to teach employment, teach these kids how to get and keep a job.
Are there any great transformational stories? Anything that you have witnessed? Like, did you get anybody ever that you thought, this kid's not going to make it, and you saw a real turnaround?
Absolutely, absolutely. That's one of the great joys in this job, is that I'm constantly proved wrong, which makes me very happy. Right when I first got here, when I first started with Liberty's Kitchen, I had a student who there was no way that this kid was going to make it. I mean, if I didn't tell him 50 times a day to pull his pants up, that was pretty much our day right there. He moved on from us, moved on to the cafe portion where they do a little more a la carte service. He really pulled it together. He had some tough times there, but he decided that this was something he was not going to fail at. So he buckled down. He graduated from the program. He got a job. And just recently, I think a week ago, he came and told us that he got his GED. And that, to me, was the one kid that I was like, never going to make it. No chance. And he completely proved me wrong and made me very happy.
Well, Chef Kevin, I want to thank you so much for taking the time out from what is an incredibly busy kitchen to talk with us.
Well, thank you so much. It's great to have y'all here, and I hope you're going to stay for lunch.
Expect to hear more from Liberty's Kitchen later this summer when they become part of the Refresh Project on North Broad Street in New Orleans. Come back, we'll hear from Chef Ryan Hughes about his new role as culinary ambassador to Russia. Is there about to be a gumbo craze in Moscow? Stay tuned. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain's. Last year, despite low cholesterol numbers, no family history of the disease, and virtually without warning, I suffered a heart attack. With the help of medication and cardio rehab, I've successfully recovered, and today I'm feeling better than ever. But I am constantly bombarded with nutritional advice about miracle cures from superfoods like kale. Recently, I sat down with our Louisiana Eats medical expert, Tim Harlan, also known as Dr. Gourmet, to investigate the truth about nutrition and cardiovascular disease.
Well, kale's really good for you, but it's not the only thing that's good for you. Kale is a cruciferous vegetable. Cruciferous meaning it's from the cabbage family. So kale's related to white cabbage and radicchio and broccoli. And we know that cruciferous vegetables are fantastic for you. They're really high in vitamin K and vitamin C and fiber. They're low in calories. And most of us love cruciferous vegetables, or at least, you know, I'm not sure you're allowed to live in the South if you don't like collard greens.
I agree.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, these are really good for you, but they're not the only thing that's going to cure or going to help treat or prevent heart disease. And we talk about this a lot, Poppy, how this is about a balance, about having a palette of great foods and great ingredients that you can make recipes from. Vegetables in general, of which kale is one, are one of those nine. So they're one of the nine things that you want to think about. More fruits and nuts is another. We know that that's great for us. More whole grains, you hear that a lot. Better quality vegetable oils, olive oil, peanut oil, canola oil. It's about that nice balance between butter and olive oil, or butter and monounsaturated fat.
Butter versus margarine.
Margarine is probably not a really good idea for any of us. And, you know, that kind of goes back to what our discussions have been about as long as we've known each other, that it's about great quality, fresh, non-processed ingredients. And margarine's just highly processed, not a great choice. More fish. Okay, we know more fish, but not a lot necessarily. Two or three times a week is kind of the target for fish, and that includes shellfish. That includes any kind of seafood. And where better to get seafood than here in
Louisiana.
And the interesting thing is meat's okay, but less meat and less processed meat. So red meat is not bad for you. Bologna is bad for you.
Yeah.
And very bad for you. And then alcohol in moderation. So it's not really, oh, you should be eating nothing but kale, or you should be eating nothing but fruit. It's about getting a lot of those and a great balance of those. And I would say the research says over and over, it's about going back into your kitchen and cooking for yourself more often than not.
Once you're in a situation where you have plaque in your arteries, is there any dietary solution that can help reduce that?
So the answer to that question is yes. Diet alone will probably not reverse heart disease. Diet alone can stop that buildup of plaque from progressing. So if you've got, say, a 20% or a 30% or a 40% blockage in your coronary arteries, you might not be able to reverse that with diet alone. So diet, exercise, stress reduction. For a lot of us, stopping smoking. Smoking, obviously, that wasn't you, but for a lot,
for a lot of us, that's simple.
But yes, there is great evidence that those three things together, really great quality Mediterranean-style diet combined with exercise, combined with stress reduction, can actually reverse heart disease. Can you clean your coronaries back to where you were when you're a baby? Probably not. And I would really urge you and everybody to not go to extremes. So eating only kale is not going to reverse all that butter you had before. But eating kale along with legumes, along with whole grains, more fish, less meat, lean meat, cooking for yourself, exercise and stress reduction, that's what's going to help stop things in their tracks and help maybe slow down some of that misspent youth that you had, Poppy, that we all had.
Well, thanks for being so inclusive on that, and thanks for making me feel better. I'm so glad we finally had a chance to have this discussion, and thanks, Tim. Please come back and talk with us again soon, personal or not.
It is always a great joy to be with you, Poppy.
Louisiana Eats medical consultant, our friend Dr. Gourmet, Tim Harlan.
Russians have, from what I've learned, a persistent stereotype that the United States does not have its own unique style or culture. So what not a better way is to take New Orleans and our unique style through music, through food, dance, photography, and bring it over there to Moscow and to the Russians and show them that, hey, Louisiana is the mecca for, I think, culture in all of the U.S.
That's Chef Ryan Hughes of Perlu, a pop-up restaurant in New Orleans. Because of his expertise in Southern cuisine, Ryan's been selected to serve as our culinary ambassador to the Usadba Jazz Festival in Russia. While he's there, he's expected to cook for as many as 40,000 guests. Of course, he can't do that alone. As the festival draws nearer, Ryan's had to guide a team of cooks through the preparation of traditional Louisiana dishes. When you're 5,000 miles away and dealing with former Soviets, Ryan's learned that the best way to command their attention is with a stiff upper lip.
Poppy, I sent him a list of about 15 different dishes that were good representations of New Orleans or Louisiana or Southern food, let's say that, you know. And I was like, all right, guys, you pick your top two, and then we'll start breaking down recipes, and I'll start teaching you how to do it via Skype and via email. So what do these guys do is, instead of picking two recipes, they email me back immediately, and they're like, okay, we'll take all 12 recipes.
Oh, goodness.
So I was like, hold on a second. No, we're not doing 12 recipes. They were like, well, we can do it all. And I'm like, no, you can't. And I thought the only really way to teach these guys that it's not as easy as just giving somebody a recipe or a dish and following through with it, I was like, okay, guys, I was like, I'll make you a deal. I'm going to give you one recipe at a time. I want you to replicate the recipe, take pictures as you go, and then send it back to me, and I'll okay it before we move on to the next recipe.
So you've been teaching via Skype already?
Via Skype and through email. Yeah. So the first recipe I gave him was seafood gumbo. So how do you teach somebody who's never even tasted a seafood gumbo before in their life, not only taste like, but replicate it for 20, 30,000 people at the same time? So I was like, look, I was like, these are the steps. I even went to my old Paul Prudhomme cookbooks. You know how great those are.
You can
look at the pictures
so
he did of the different stages of roux and where to take certain roux and how to cut the vegetables, and this is the right size of shrimp and whatnot. So I showed him via pictures, and sure enough, it took him almost a week and a half just to get down the gumbo recipe. This is what, without me obviously even tasting it, where I felt that I was even able to get him to a point where we can step in a couple days earlier and then me adjust certain
and tweak
things.
It.
And
yeah.
Then just tweak it. Exactly.
So what else have you taught them now?
So I taught them the seafood gumbo. And then, okay, so think about, you know, your typical Louisiana or fair or festival food that represents our culture. So I did some studying, and sure enough, all over Russia are crayfish.
Crawfish.
Exactly. Crawfish. So I started looking up recipes, and back in the day when there were all these czars, you know, before communist Russia, they had all the best top French classical chefs working for these gazillionaires, whatnot, you know, these people. And the classical French way to do a crawfish dish was, if you look up, it's called nantua, which is basically a creamed crawfish. And they put it sometimes over rice or with crepes or a vol-au-vent or whatnot. So I was like, can you get crawfish? And of course, they corrected me, crayfish. Yes, we can get crayfish. And I'm like, okay, here's a recipe for a crawfish boil. They've got the corn, they got potatoes, and we figured out that they have a similar type of sausage as andouille. It's a smoked large sausage. So I sent them the recipe with all the pictures, and I gave them the great pictures. We all see this of picnic tables with the crawfish all sprawled out on newspaper. And this also works really well because they actually weigh the product, and that's how they charge for it. A couple days later, I get a email response. He's got 20 different pictures of the stages of a crawfish boil. They showed me this picture, and it's on this fancy porcelain plate that's got like the scalloped edges and rims. And there are, I'm not kidding, Poppy, it's three crawfish the size of small lobsters perched on top of each other with like a little fennel frond garnish on top. And that was the crawfish boil. They thought that the corn, the meat, you know, the andouille and the potatoes were, and the whole garlic, you got to have that, of course, in the crawfish bowl, was just a flavoring component in there. And the end result was just a couple crawfish that were perched on a plate to do that.
Clearly, something's been lost in the translation. But Ryan takes it all in stride. He's sent more pictures and spoken firmly with members of the crew to right their wrongs, but he's still unsure about what could happen later this summer. He does know one thing. Strong-arm tactics might be all the rage for certain Russian leaders, but that's not his style.
When I started Skyping with him, as soon as they popped up on the screen, that was the first time I saw them, and here I am talking to these people in Russia. What do? You smile, right? Because you want to greet people. There were no smiles to be had.
Wow.
No, not at all.
And so even your body language, you're going to have to be very cautious about.
Well, you know what? I don't want to be that way. You know, I like to be friendly with people, you know, and I think us going over there as Americans, I'm not going to adapt to not shaking hands or smiling at people or anything. And if we can bring friendliness and outreaching a hand to people and showing that that is an okay thing to do, I think that's a good thing.
Once Ryan recovers from the jet lag, he'll be back with us on Louisiana Eats to give us the whole lowdown on the Russian caper. Until then, he'll be posting updates on his Purlieu New Orleans Facebook page. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. Can't wait to hear what the Russians will say about Louisiana dirty rice. It's my guess that a dish with the name dirty might be a little confusing to translators. In any case, our fearless culinary ambassador, Chef Ryan Hughes, will be introducing his dirty rice to the Muscovites this summer. Ryan shared his recipe so that we can all have a taste of what they'll soon be chowing down on in Russia. He begins by browning diced tasso with bay leaves, mustard, cumin, onion, celery, bell pepper, and garlic in a little oil. He adds the rice and continues to stir, scraping the bottom of the pot until the rice begins to make a popping sound. Now here comes a shocker. Ryan mixes chicken stock with some good old Jack Daniels and adds it to the rice mixture, bringing the whole thing to a boil before adding some ground chicken livers. He reduces the heat to low, covers the pot, and in just 10 minutes, the dirty rice is ready to serve. For a copy of Ryan's recipe, visit our Louisiana Eats website. I'm Poppy Tooker, and Chef Ryan Hughes' dirty rice is real Louisiana Eats. What makes filet so unique to Louisiana cuisine? Stay tuned, and we'll learn just what makes our filet powder so special. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Markets. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. What makes filet so unique to Louisiana's cuisine? Filet powder is made from the tender young leaves of the sassafras tree, only native to North America and Eastern Asia. It was introduced to the original Louisiana settlers by the Native Americans, who used it for flavoring, thickening, and to break fevers, because when ingested, it can make you break out in a sweat. The French settlers called it filet, which translates thread, because of that stringy, thread-like texture it can give liquids. But the Choctaw name for it was gumbo. Is that where gumbo got its name? I'm afraid that's a mystery we'll never know the answer to. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. When he's not covering the restaurant scene for the New Orleans Advocate, Ian McNulty is rambling the roads of Louisiana looking for hot spots to talk to our Louisiana Eats listeners about. So, Ian, where you been rambling?
Well, Poppy, we're going back out to the Cajun Prairie today. And I know you will remember, and I hope some of your listeners will remember, the town of Krotz Springs and how this little town on Highway 190 has sort of a Boudin ball war going on between the butcher shops and the gas stations that serve Boudin to try to draw in motorists with various alterations on the standard Boudin and Boudin ball. But today I want to talk about one of the main players there, Billy's. It's probably one of the better known Boudin purveyors in that area. Has actually spread out quite a bit over the years. Now, Krotz Springs is sort of where they're home-based and most famous for. Billy's also has a location in Scott, Louisiana. But also, and for me, I think a little more interesting, is this Billy's in Opelousas. And right off when you get off the highway, before you get into town, you'll see this Billy's Boudin. The interesting thing here is that it's sort of a double-branded Boudin stop. It's Billy's Boudin, and it's also Ray's Boudin. And when you see the sign, it sometimes looks like Billy Ray's, like, you know, a real Southern name or something. But these are actually two different brands run by the same guy under the same roof. So the guy behind Billy's Boudin bought the recipe for this old Ray's Boudin and serves them side by side right there in this one butcher shop Boudin stop.
So what's the difference between Billy and Ray?
Well, they're different recipes. And, you know, people who love Boudin can go chapter and verse on the different varieties and the texture and the taste and the pepper and the liver and the casing and every little thing you can think of to differentiate what on paper looks like the exact same dish. Personally, I give the nod to the Billy's version. To me, it's just a texture thing. I like the texture a little more. Ray's has a little more liver flavor if you're into that. Maybe that's a little more old-fashioned, traditional. But it's a very interesting place because, you know, for people like me, and I know there's others out there who, when they travel around Cajun country, whether they're on a road trip or running an errand, they might like to try a few different types of Boudin. And here's a place under one roof where you can get both. Now, not only the Boudin, but the whole realm of sort of Boudin alterations that have cropped up. The Boudin balls, Boudin egg rolls, and a new one on me the last time I was out there was the Boudin roll-up. Very similar to a Boudin egg roll, but more of a wonton or a dumpling shape, and a real sort of pop-in-your-mouth snack. I mean, these things are, you know, two or three bites max.
Wow.
So when you're traveling around the Cajun Prairie, you can stop in these places. And the great thing about this Billy's in Opelousas, this Billy's and this Ray's, is it's a drive-thru.
Oh,
yeah.
So you don't even have to get out of your car.
That's right. You know, most Boudin is consumed in the car, it seems. And here's one where you don't even have to get out of your car or truck, more to the point, probably. For those of us who like this stuff and just collect it and like to bring it home and share it with friends and eat it on the road, it just keeps on getting richer and richer out there.
Well, thanks for letting us in on your secrets, Ian. And please come back and tell us some more news on the road soon, would you?
Always a pleasure, Poppy.
Louisiana Eats rambling reporter, Ian McNulty. Cory Bahr, one of Louisiana's hottest young chefs, hails from Monroe, Louisiana. He's changing the way North Louisiana food is regarded and becoming quite a national superstar along the way. Cory, welcome to Louisiana Eats.
Hey, Poppy, I'm so happy to be here.
Let's just start at the very start. How did your life in food begin?
My life in food began as a child, really. My grandparents, they raised me in North Louisiana, you know, and they were always cooking. Their parents were always cooking. They were always cooking. We were always doing something in the kitchen. And, you know, that's where the family spent most of the time.
So what happened when you were 16?
My grandmother was diagnosed with lymphoma. And I had to move with my dad. And, you know, that was kind of a life-changing scenario right there.
And so you quit school?
Yeah, I quit school and found a life in the service industry. So that was really a, a blessing in disguise. My grandmother went into remission, has been so ever since, and still alive and kicking, and just an awesome inspiration still to this day.
Well, I'm particularly fascinated by the fact that you jumped into the food industry at the age of 16, and as far as I can tell, you don't have any culinary school background.
No, actually, I didn't really get to stage with any known chefs until after I'd kind of, I guess you'd say, made a little name for myself. So all of my technique is self-taught, and I was highly motivated to learn food. And some of my earliest memories of, like, seeing before Food Network or anything like that were, you know, great chefs of the world came on LPB. We had three channels in Lake Providence, Louisiana, you know, and LPB was one of them, and that's typically what we were watching. So, you know, I was just fascinated by not only the show itself, but the MC's voice and how her enunciation of words and how well she spoke, and it was a really awesome show to watch, you know.
When you were coming up as a young chef, you did a lot of traveling. You were around and about.
I did, but I didn't. I did a lot of traveling when I was young and in the service industry, but I didn't do the fancy traveling. I never went to France for 6 months and worked for Joël Robuchon or the Trois Gros brothers or anything like that. But, you know, I did a lot of traveling in the South and also a little bit in Texas, kind of from Atlanta, a little bit in New Orleans and then San Antonio and that area.
Anybody in particular influence your food?
I mean, to be honest with you, not really. I mean, my food kind of hails from where I'm from. A lot of what I did was read cookbooks by people I really admired and have since had the pleasure to meet and hang out with and share a few cocktails with.
But, like who?
You know, we've got Frank Stitt in Birmingham, obviously Susan Spicer here in New Orleans, but also some of the old ones. I mean, we go back to even some of our local cookbooks in my area, like Cotton Country Collection and things like that. They're just so cool. You know, Thomas Keller for technique, people like that. But really, it all started off just, like I said, blood and guts and work your butt off. You know, that's how it came about. And just dedication, hard work, and persistence. And that's really what's paid off for me in the long run.
That's the story of the restaurant business, huh?
It is. I mean, there's no other way to do it. You know, you're fortunate enough to have guests walking through your door with high expectations, and you better succeed or they're not going to come back. And we try to exceed guest expectations in my restaurant on a daily basis. We're not always successful, but more so than not, and we're working at it every day.
Well, I think that your story is very pertinent and really important to young people who are interested
in
this business.
Yeah, you know, Louisiana is known for its food and its hospitality, and the service industry in Louisiana thrives like no other in the country, in my opinion. I mean, I've had the opportunity to travel quite a bit, and man, home is just where it's at as far as food and service go. And we're going to start working on that in my part of the state to have more hospitality and culinary training programs throughout the state. We already have some great ones, you know, Delgado and obviously John Folse's Nickel State and everything. But more small communities, I think, could benefit from that, where maybe there's not as many outlets for the young people. And you know, because school's not for everybody. I mean, I hate to say that, you know, but it's some people are more tactile learners or hands-on, and the action of the service industry and the energy of it can attract some people who are maybe not as book-focused, I guess you would say.
A lot of times I get these questions from kids who are either graduating from high school or they've gotten a bachelor's degree, and all of a sudden they think the answer to their lives is the Culinary Institute.
Right. Or I have some kids now that are coming through. I have the benefit of having some stagiaires, some interns out of a ProStart program locally in my city, and I don't try to steer them away from culinary school because I think some people, that benefits some people. But other people, I think it's more intelligent maybe to go and work for the best chefs you can and have hands-on training, because that real-world experience is where it's at. You know, it's kind of like going to med school. You learn a lot from the books. It's kind of like reading cookbooks. But until you put your hands on a patient, or until you put your hands on that subprimal part of a pig or something like that, you know, you just don't know. And Louisiana has so many great restaurants and so many wonderful chefs that are open to those sort of things, bringing in the next generation, if you will, to kind of take the torch and run with it.
You have described the style of cooking that you do as creative Southern cuisine. Tell us what that means.
Well, yeah, it's taking like heritage foods that I grew up with, my family cooked, that were locally available, and kind of reinventing them. We have some wonderful local farmers that we're using that are just, they're the inspiration for what we do now, which is so nice. But we just take things, you know, your typical North Delta food, really, your squash, your root veg, greens, things like that, and just twist them a little bit. You know, we use a lot of techniques, like my grandmother, for instance, always put vinegar in her water when she cooked her greens. You know, you don't see that in a cookbook anywhere, but it's how you bring those things along and how you cook your peppers in with it and everything else. It's just those are what we're using, those old kind of heritage techniques.
Just dissect for me one dish that our listeners might be familiar with that you have morphed into your new way.
Well, like some of the things that we're doing, like we do fried okra at the restaurant, but, and you know, fried okra and ketchup go together great, but we actually, we're making a ketchup that's based on one of my great grandmother's sort of recipes for a tomato condiment, if you will, mm-hmm. That is similar to ketchup, but it has, you know, molasses and things like that. And really, 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 really neat recipe. But with the okra, we're actually taking, local okra and pickling it and then cornmeal tempura frying it.
Ooh.
So it's just simple stuff like that. We're not really trying to reinvent the wheel. We're just taking great Southern food and turning it just a little bit.
Let's talk about your restaurant, Cotton.
Sure.
Why'd you call it Cotton?
You know, Cotton is a huge part of where we're from. We're in the western part of the North Delta. Huge cotton farms all around. And the building itself is from the 1890s. It was cotton storage on the top floor of the building. So it just made sense. It's part of where we're from. And we just get out of the food's way. We use our traditional Southern techniques to really enhance what we've already got and just get out of its way and let it do its thing.
Well, you're making me hungry for a visit to Monroe.
Absolutely. We'd love to have you, Poppy.
Cory Bahr of Monroe's Cotton Restaurant. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Join us next week for a summertime visit with Louisiana's own hot dog guy, Dat Dog's Skip Murray.
And he gave me this thing in encased meats, and I never had that before. Soft, crusty roll, hard on the outside, nice and soft on the inside, and I never went back to hot dogs.
Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Have you made a love connection at Tales of the Cocktail? Our friends and sponsors at Dickie Brennan's Palace Cafe want to hear your story of love at Tales. Submit your story to love at palacecafe.com by Wednesday, June 9th. One lucky winner will receive a romantic dinner for two at the Palace Cafe and a pair of tasting room wristbands for all 5 days of this year's Tales of the Cocktail. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by Linda Green, the Yakaman Ladies Soul Food Catering. Our media sponsor is Louisiana Life Magazine, the magazine of a great state. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Thanks to producer Thomas Walsh and sound engineer Joe Schreiner. I'm Poppy Tooker. We'll see you next time. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.